We will now start our regular press conference by Foreign Minister Motegi. From my side, I would like to speak about three things first. First, related to East Japan earthquake. 10 years on from the Great East Japan earthquake, yesterday, I issued a foreign minister's statement. Once again, I pray for the victims, and I would like to extend my heartfelt condolences to the bereaved families from around the world. We received so much support and words of encouragement, and at this juncture of 10 years, we once again received warm messages and words of prayer. We are so very grateful. Yesterday at Minami Sanriku, Australian Deputy Chief of Mission in Tokyo and Australian Consul General in Osaka attended the memorial ceremony. The two were working in the embassy in Tokyo 10 years ago and extended support to the affected areas and other staff with the other staff of the embassy. This time, they were once again posted in Japan and attended the memorial ceremony. Yesterday, there were many memorial events held around the world. Japan will never forget the warm sympathies and support from people around the world. Tomodachi, friendship from the United States and many other countries around the world. That friendship is being shared. Even after 10 years since the earthquake, there are still import restrictions on Japanese food products and other important issues remaining. There can be no revival of Japan without the reconstruction in Tohoku. That is our strong determination. We will continue to work with all our force. Also, in recent years, with climate change, there's frequent extreme weather events in many places around the world. Natural disasters are becoming even more severe. We will also step up our international cooperation through disaster reduction. Second point, Hong Kong. From March 5th to the 11th, yesterday, National People's Congress was held in China. We were watching closely its developments, and yesterday at the Congress, a decision on the change in the election system of Hong Kong Special Administrative Region was taken. Last year in June, the National Security Law was enacted. Thereafter, many pro-democracy legislators and activists have been arrested and prosecuted. And this time around, at the National People's Congress, this decision was taken to change Hong Kong's election system, and we are gravely concerned. Especially, this decision this time undermines the Hong Kong Basic Law, which has supported Hong Kong's development, and further erodes the trust in the One Country, Two Systems based on Sino-British Joint Statement of 1984. It greatly retrogresses the high level of autonomy of Hong Kong, and Japan cannot condone this development. Under One Country, Two Systems, Hong Kong maintaining a free and open system and to develop democratically and stably, this is important, and this has been the consistent position of Japan. The Japanese government calls for relevant elections in Hong Kong to be implemented in a fair way with candidates representing a wide variety of political views. And this view has been communicated to the Chinese side once again in response to this decision. We will continue to work with the international community to call for concrete response from the Chinese side.
The third point in today's cabinet meeting, with regards to the white paper on Development Cooperation 2020, I made some remarks. This white paper is subtitled International Cooperation for the Future in the Corona Era. It has special features introducing the health and medical assistance implemented with unprecedented speed, and also contribution to ensuring equitable access to vaccines, and the Japanese staff in international agencies actively working in the world. This also aims to be a participatory white paper. It features photos taken by the general public and also articles submitted through an SNS and other channels. Those ideas were adopted so that broader people will feel a sense of closeness to the white paper. Through this white paper, we hope to gain understanding and further support from the general public for development cooperation. And Japan will continue to demonstrate leadership in developing cooperation in the international community and actively contribute to resolving global challenges. That is all from my side.
We will now take your questions. Please raise your hand, and when you're designated, step up to the microphone and state your name and affiliation. Please. Yamamoto-san. Yamamoto from NHK. Prime Minister Suga's visit to the United States. Early part of April, he's reported to visit the United States, according to the Chief Cabinet Secretary. What are the achievements expected to be reached? And the people who are to accompany him is to be limited to a smallest number. Are you planning to go along with Prime Minister Suga? Early part of April, the Prime Minister is to visit the United States. Today, there's going to be the Quad Summit meeting, a first summit meeting between Japan, US, Australia, and India. At a very early timing after the launch of the Biden administration, this summit meeting is to be held. Japan-US alliance for strengthening of the alliance, it shows the strong commitment of the Biden administration for the alliance, and we welcome this development. And based on this alliance between Japan and the United States, urgent regional situations, as well as Indo-Pacific, which is free and open, a realization of free and open Indo-Pacific and Japan-US cooperation for that, climate change, COVID-19 countermeasures. There are various common challenges in the international community against which Japan and US will work together to exercise leadership. And this is going to be a great, meaningful opportunity to show that once again. Obviously, COVID countermeasures will have to be thoroughly taken, and therefore the number of people is going to be kept to a minimum. At this point in time, I am not planning to accompany Prime Minister Suga. Next question, please.
Fukuda-san, please. This is Fukuda of Yomiuri. In relation to that, regarding Prime Minister's visit to the U.S. and Quad's leaders meeting, and also Mr. Blinken's visit to Asian countries, the new U.S. administration seems to place more importance on Asia in their diplomatic actions. What are your views on this? What is your reaction? The Biden administration, looking at Asia, and also focusing on the Indo-Pacific region, the U.S. is showing its posture to commit to these regions. I believe this is important, and as Japan, we welcome such posture of the U.S. Of course, going forward in the U.S., the Biden administration will cooperate with allies and partners, so that various issues in the world will be addressed through a demonstration of leadership. Of course, that is what we want. Therefore, such a leadership must be shown and demonstrated, and a further strengthening of our relationships with the allies and partners must follow. So from these perspectives, I do not intend on naming specific countries, but we believe the U.S. Has recognized the importance of Asia. Next question, please.
Azahari-san, please.
Just to follow up on this question. On the summit, I think you will discuss Indo-Pacific region, and how the other areas in the world will be discussed, basically, in this summit, namely the Middle East, in relation to the Pacific Indian region, because the Middle East is close to the Indian Ocean. Thank you.
First, free and open Indo-Pacific. This includes, obviously, the Middle East geographically. And based on that, peace process, Middle East peace process. The U.S. has a lot of influence in on the region, so we would like to coordinate with U.S. and other relevant countries to promote a corridor for peace and prosperity, as well as CPAD, Conference on Cooperation Amongst East Asian Countries for Palestinian Development, to try to build confidence. And the Middle East situation, it's not just the United States, but Australia and India and other important partners are involved in our discussion. And obviously, we have a long-standing favorable relationships with Middle Eastern countries over the years. So we'd like to leverage this relationship to contribute to peace and stability of the region and to work closely with other partners in our diplomatic efforts.
Thank you, Azhari, again. In this,
Azhari, again.
The Houthis are firing missiles against the cross-border, against Saudi Arabia, including recent missiles that reportedly hit Aramco oil company, and also maybe some, according to reports, some civilian facilities. How does Japan see this situation?
Well, in Yemen, a conflict has prolonged, and from of course, we have concerns that civilians are placed in a very tough situation. The Houthis exerting power in the region is something we criticize in various aspects. Japan is urging Yemen to stop this conflict and to early a resolution of the problem. And the special ambassador to the UN, Griffiths, and his efforts are highly appreciated. We will continue to cooperate with the countries concerned to extend humanitarian assistance and also exert efforts to realize stability and peace in Yemen. Regarding this situation, at the visit to Saudi Arabia last year and the other day, we also had an exchange of opinions with the Mr. Zarif of Yemen, and our views were communicated at these occasions.
Next question, please. Ishinabe-san. Ishinabe from Sankei Shimbun. China and their vaccine is my question. IOC President Bach said that from China for Tokyo Olympic Games and Beijing Olympic Games to the athletes and other officials, they are prepared to provide their vaccine from China. What's your reaction? And what is the intention of the Chinese side? This is a matter of the Olympic Games. Has to do with the IOC. Furthermore, vaccine. These are issues that is outside of the purview of mine. Therefore, I would like to refrain from answering that question.
This is Yamamoto of NHK. Regarding Japan-U.S. 2+2, what is the outcome that you hope to achieve? And also, vis-a-vis China, will there be a strong message from Japan and U.S. on this point? After the establishment of the Biden administration, at this early timing, the State Secretary of the U.S. Is visiting Japan as the first foreign country to visit. I believe that this speaks to the importance U.S. places on the alliance between Japan and the U.S., and we welcome that. And at this opportunity, we hope to exchange opinions on the security environment, which is toughening in the region, and to discuss future cooperation to strengthen the Japan-U.S. alliance in this face-to-face meeting and to show this to the international community. Regarding foreign ministers' meeting between Japan and the U.S. With Mr. Blinken, we had three occasions to have conference calls. But for this time, for the first time, we will have a face-to-face meeting. So regarding the topics that I mentioned, we will have ample time to discuss and to align between Japan and the U.S. and to also further strengthen the personal relationship of trust between ourselves. As for specific outcome of the meeting with regards to the foreign ministers meeting or either 2+2, we will have on-the-spot interviews and also press conferences after the meeting. They will be scheduled. So at these occasions, I hope to announce the outcome.
Are there any other questions? If none, then we would like to bring to a close this press conference. Thank you very much.